Jesus Christ, thank you for the health and strength to walk up those steps and enter the gates and courts of your house, Heavenly Father. Thou art Almighty God from everlasting to everlasting. God, for the service today and the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost to break every yoke of bondage. Crystal River, the musicians and singers, Brother Danny Lee, and our mind and attention to be upon you, to praise you and to worship you. And before we leave the house of God this blessed day, let us be thankful that we are blessed to be in your presence this blessed day. In Jesus' loving and precious name, we do pray and thank you. And the church and the body of Christ here today, give God a great big welcome. Turn each and every neighbor's hand, tell him it's good to see him in the house of the Lord.
God, we love.
Word of God said the thief cometh not but to kill, steal, and he comes to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. You know, as we look around to Satan, Brother Monty, he's having a field day with this year where you can't come to the house of God and brothers and sisters sit in fellowship and feel the presence of God. But what we got to do is trust in the Lord with all our heart. Lean not to their own understanding. In all the ways, we got to acknowledge Him, and He's going to direct our path. Amen. Therefore, Micah said, Micah 7, 7 and 8, he said, therefore I will look unto the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. That means He heard your cry here in the house of God. My God will hear me. Rejoice not against me, O my enemy. When I fall, I shall arise. I'm going to get up. When I sit in darkness, God's going to be a light. That means He's been a light or two here in the house of God. Well, somebody give Him praise from the front pew to the back pew to the clap. God's been good to us, and God's blessed us. Crystal River, take your remedy, please. Isaiah's going to the house of God.
He's all tore up, Jack, and King Uzziah's died. He said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon the throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the serpent, each one having six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another, Holy, 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 amen. The Lord of hosts, the whole earth is full of his glory. How many feels the glory of God here this blessed day? If the angels and the serpent are worshiping him, you and I should be worshiping the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the giver of life and life above him. My Lord God, give him a great big clap for me. Clap your hands on your people. Gather the life on the time. Mr. River, take your liberty, please.
Yes, hallelujah!
In the good old
It's good praise in the house of the Lord. Yeah. I didn't have to come, but I got to come. Thank you for your patience. And I tell you, it's so good to see you and to be in the presence of God. When I first came in, someone gave me a little bag that said "Open Now." And inside of it was a t-shirt that did something about being fired up or something. But then Brian came in with 3 bags of hot peppers. And I thought, well, he must be trying to tell me something. I tell you, I feel God's fire in my heart this morning. Amen. What a privilege and honor it is to step into the presence of Almighty God. I have the opportunity to stand before you and handle His Word. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Psalm 61, verses 1 through 3. And the anointing, you know, it comes when people pray. It comes when people want Him to come. I don't have a switch that I turn on and off. It's all up to you and God. But I believe that God's here, and He has a desire to touch us and to help us today. Psalms 61, beginning with verse 1, continuing through verse 3. Hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. Yes. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. Pray with me if you would, Eternal Father. We thank you, we praise and we worship you. For your loving kindness is better than life, for all your goodness that's bestowed upon us. Lord, lead us to that rock this morning. Anoint us and grant us your liberty, we pray. Touch every heart, meet every need. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray in the church. Say amen and give Him praise for His word this morning. Since we have not been together for such a long time, it is my desire that I could, some way, somehow, give you something, not I, but the presence of God, give you something to take home with you this morning. I want to speak to you on a thought, the cure for a heart that is overwhelmed. Perhaps nowhere in all of Holy Scripture will you and I find another man so in love with God than the one who speaks from the Word today. When God looked unto His people to choose a king, it was said that He sought for a man after His own heart, and He chose David. While David did not write all the Psalms, he did write many of them. And in these songs, he reveals his feelings toward his Creator. In Psalms 3, he sees Jehovah as his shield, his glory, and the lifter up of his hand. In Psalms 4, he tells us that God has put gladness in his heart. In Psalms 5, he informs the reader that the Lord will bless the righteous. In Psalms 6, he tells the reader that the Lord will receive his prayer. In Psalms 7, David tells us that the Lord is his defense. In Psalms 8, he tells us that God has put all things under his feet. In Psalms 9, he tells us that God will not forsake them that seek him. In Psalms 11, he says, God's countenance doth behold the upright. In Psalms 12, he said, God will preserve. In Psalms 14, David says that God will deliver his people from their captivity. In the 16th chapter, he tells a believer that God will show us the path of life, and he shall find joy in his presence. In the 17th vision, David tells us, when we cry out to God, He will hear us. In chapter 18, God delivers the psalmist from his enemy. He drew me out of many waters, were David's exact words. In the 20th chapter, David announces that the Lord will send help in the sanctuary. I did not come in vain this morning, nor did you come in vain this morning, for He said, for as many as 2 or 3 have gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Somebody give Him praise in His house this morning. And in Psalms 23, David tells us that God is a shepherd, providing his sheep with everything that they need to be both healthy and productive. I could spend the entire sermon reminding us of the many positions that David recognized that God filled in the life of the believer. All the strength, all the courage, all the hope, direction, joy, confidence, encouragement, and a thousand other things that God does for us daily. But time demands that I stop here and press toward the subject. The point that I wish to make today, with the mention of all these quotes from David, is that he saw God as being all that he needed in order to be successful in the battles that he would encounter in life. Not only was God all that David needed in order to be successful in all of his battles, God is all you need. God is all that I need to be successful in this encounter that I have with the adversary, the encounter that you have with your adversary. Give God praise. While David, like all of us, was a man plagued with many failures, it is obvious as we read after him that he possessed a relationship with God that few men have achieved. As chapter 61 of the Psalms opens, it is apparent that the psalmist who saw God as being all that he needed was in despair. Were we looking for a time in David's life when these words were penned and this occasion occurred, it could possibly be after the defeat of Absalom, when he had attempted to overthrow his father as ruler of the kingdom, and yet before David returned to Jerusalem to reclaim his position on the throne of Israel, when Absalom, David's young charismatic son, conspired with some of the people and attempted to steal the kingdom from his father. David was given advice from his council to leave the palace, to leave the holy city, and to flee into the wilderness. It does not require much of an imagination to gain some understanding of how David would have felt at such a time under such circumstances. He was distant from everything that he loved. David was the greatest king that Israel ever had, and the greatness had its roots in the love that he had for the people. Now he was distant from the palace and consequently unable to govern, but his love for the palace and his ability to govern was dwarfed for his love for the temple. While the temple then was somewhat comparable to the church this morning, the creature was much more restricted when it came to his fellowship with God. Actually, it was only the high priest who came into the very presence of the great God Jehovah. But even with those extreme restrictions, David saw the temple as being God's house. That being the case, the temple was the most special place in all the world to David. I don't know about you, but I, when I walk through this house and it's empty, my heart, it breaks when I walk through this place and I see it empty. My heart hurts on the inside, because inside of me there's a special place. It's called the house of God, where he said he would meet with me and he would meet with you. You didn't come to see me today, nor did you come to hear me today. You came, you made your way into this house because it's God's house, and you expect God to be here, and your expectations are revealed this morning. Give him your praise. He loved the temple so much that he is envious of the birds that nested in the eaves. Although he is the most important figure in all of Israel, with servants to take care of his every need, in Psalms 84:10 he said, "Listen, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. His attendance to God's house was never something that he had to force himself to do. In fact, it was David who penned the words that are so often quoted from behind this pulpit in Psalms 122 and 1 when he said, I was glad when they said, let us go unto the house of the Lord. Can somebody say amen? It could have been, we could not have been here today, but God made it possible for you and I to come, not into the presence of each other alone, but into the presence of Manna, Masika, Hulam, of the Almighty God of heaven. Under the circumstances, going into the house of the Lord was not possible for David now. Now his distance from the thing that he loved most made him feel as if he was at the end of the earth. And yet from what he had determined to be an extreme distance, so distant that he perceives it as being the end of the earth, David turns his attention to God and he said, I cry unto thee. Oh God, let me tell you something. God will not ever disappoint you. He said, if you'll call unto me, I'll hear you and I'll answer you and I'll show you great and mighty things that you're unaware of. Your cry to God in your despair, in your time of need, does not go unheard. He said, I'll hear you every time you cry. Every need you have, bring it to Him. Praise Him this morning. Although prayer is seen by many in the church as a responsibility, rather than something to do as a last-ditch effort, while a statement that is often made by believers is, I guess all we can do is pray. Actually, prayer, the ability to communicate with Almighty God, is the most powerful weapon in the believer's arsenal. He can separate you from the adversary, can separate you from the house of God. The adversary can separate you from the fellowship with your brothers and sisters. But there's one thing that he does not have the ability to do. He cannot separate me, and he cannot separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The pastor may not be there. The elders may not be there. The choir may not be there. The special singers may not be there. The moderator may not be there. But God will be there. He is with you all the way even to the end of the world. Over and over in the psalm, David makes reference to prayer and God's response to that act. The 18th division of the psalm, David said that he cried unto his God in a time of distress. Listen closely.
Right.
He heard my voice. My cry came before him even unto his ears. And God responded. The earth shook and trembled.
Right.
The foundations also of the hills moved and were shaken because he was wroth. Honey, prayer is not a last-ditch effort. Prayer is the very first action that we should take. Sincere prayer from a child of God never falls upon deaf ears. He is listening. One writer said he hath inclined his ears to hear what we have to say to him. Thank God he hears our cry. May God help us to quit petitioning him with our lips while we doubt him in our heart. We're commanded to believe that we cannot prove, to grasp hold of what we cannot see, to lay claim to those promises already made. I cannot touch him with my physical arm. I cannot lay my hand on him with my physical hand, but I can touch him. My God, I can touch him with my cry, and so can you. Somebody who knows that he's somewhere listening, give him your praise this morning. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee, David said. Can I tell you today that any good Christian soldier worth his or her salt has stood and shall stand again in such a place, a place that appears to be thousands of miles from God, a time when the heavens seem to be grass and your cry not getting through. Peter was at the ends of the earth when he cried out, "Carest thou not that we perish?" The disciples were there when the storm overtook them in the midst of the sea. Paul and Silas were there after they had been beaten and placed in stocks in the jail at Philippi. Paul found himself in this spiritual location when the sun had not shined for many days. The tackling of the ship had been thrown overboard, and the ship was being driven by the wind out of control. Our spiritual location is rarely the fair havens. Listen to me, our natural environment is a battlefield. The condition of our sea is normally dangerous. I want to tell you that again. Let me say to you, and we need to get this into our heart and get this into our mind, that every day is not spent in the fair havens. Our natural surrounding is a battlefield. The condition of our sea is normally dangerous, but God is always present. There's an old song that I used to remember. It says, "Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus." How many of you have had your dark places and those are overshadowed by the difficulties that life has brought against you? And how many of you are here to be honest and say, "Pastor, I've even wondered if God even cared. I've wondered if God was even listening, if God was even watching. Am I the only one has ever been there? But thank God, I was mistaken. You were mistaken. God cared for me then. God was present then, even in the worship service when His glory filled the temple. The presence of God was with me in my trial, in my temptation, in my greatest difficulty. In the shadows, there was always Jesus."
Amen.
The quest of a certain hotel for being aggravated by a little girl who possessed no ability to make music but constantly thumped on the piano. They complained to the proprietor, "Have the little girl stop." The proprietor responded by saying, "I'm sorry that you're annoyed, but the girl belongs to one of my best guests, and I cannot ask her not to play the piano. But her father, who is away for a few days, will return tomorrow. You can then approach him, and he'll solve the matter." The father returned to find his daughter in the reception room as usual, thumping on the piano. He walked up behind the little girl, put his arms over her shoulders, took her hands in his, and produced the most beautiful music that anyone had ever heard. Let me tell you, there are those times when life does not seem to be adding up, when life seems to be falling apart, and we cannot make beautiful music. We cannot sing a beautiful song. All at once, Randy, the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost of God, walks up behind us, lays his hands across our shoulders, takes our hands in his. Oh, it from the music we can make. Dear God, have you ever walked out of that place of despair? Have you ever walked out of that place of where there was nothing and nothingness? Have you ever walked out of that place of hurt and worry and anxiety? Because all of a sudden the Spirit of God laid his hands across your shoulder, took his hands in yours, and you made beautiful music. If God be with us, and if God be for us, who can be against us? You see, I know more about you than you think I do. You know more about me than I think you do. But I know that I'm preaching to people that are hurting this morning. If I weren't, then I wouldn't be preaching this way. But I came to tell you that worry is real. I came to tell you that trials are real. I came to tell you that difficulties are real. But I also came to lay this on you. God is real. I said God is real. My God, he's not a pigment of our imagination. God is real. He's there all the time. In the nighttime, in the daytime, when it's dark and dreary, there is a God that is with us always. Due to the circumstances that we may be facing, the music that we're producing today, it may be like that the little girl was making, a clamber, disharmony. But Christ has provided a gift. It's called prayer. And when we pray believing, he shall put his arms over our shoulder, take our hands in his, and shall make beautiful music. Have you ever went into your prayer room like a dog that had been beaten? And in your mind you were saying, God, if something doesn't change, this is as far as I can go. But into your prayer closet you made your way, and there you found it was not empty. But there was someone there, and you supped with him, and he supped with you. And when you walked out, you had your head up high, and you were looking good because you realized that you were ambassador of the Son of Almighty God. I tell you, men and women, real men and women, are made in their prayer closet.
Amen.
Our overcoming does not come with the anointing of the pastor. Our overcoming comes when we make our way out of a prayer closet, when we touch the hem of his garment, and we've been made whole. We need to realize that prayer is not just something to open up with and to finish off with. Prayer is to be constant and consistent in our lives. Every day, we need to touch the hand that desires to touch us. There's something that flows through that relationship called prayer. If you've ever touched him and he's ever touched you, give him your praise, God. David said, when my heart is overwhelmed. Webster speaks to the extremity of the condition when he tells us that overwhelmed means to bury or submerge completely, as with a wave or a flood, to overcome to the feet. But what did David do? Did he continue to attempt to make his way out of that terrible condition alone? Was this man, after God's own heart, content to remain overcome by defeat? No, David said, when I feel so low, when I cannot feel God, when I can't hear God, and I doubt that God is hearing me, I feel so distant from him, and my comparison would be the end of the earth, then the Lord lead me to that rock. When I think that it's all over and everything's going down the drain, take me to that rock. Thank God there's security in that rock. There is stability in that rock. My God, there is strength. There is power in that rock. It's available. like a blind man who has wandered from his accustomed path would say, lead me. What a lame man would say after falling because of his great weakness, lead me. What a terrified man would say who had to pass along the edge of a bottomless ravine, lead me. May we cry out to the rock this morning, the rock that cannot be shaken, the rock that cannot be moved, lead me to that rock.
Amen.
David's cry was not to another man like himself. His cry was not to another who was capable of failure. Thank God it was to the hand of the Almighty that he called upon for assistance. The songwriter Thomas Dorsey, he captures the act of divine help in his song, Take My Hand, Precious Lord. Listen to this. When my way groweth drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call. Hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Oh God, I could just barely get that out. I wish I could sing it, but I can't. I tell you, there's a God that's got a hold of your hand. How many of you remember the day? I remember the day when Jesus found me. Raise your hand if you remember that day. You know what he did that day? He took your hand. My God in heaven, if I've ever felt the power of God, I feel him this morning. He took me by the hand and he said to the adversary, you take it out. Take it out if you can. And after 50 years, I came to declare to you that hell and the hells of hells cannot take you from the hand of the God that saved you. It makes no difference how dark. It makes no difference what's falling apart. It makes no difference what's taking place. God has your hand. You say, he's got my back. No. He's got your hand. If he's got your hand, he'd take care of your back. I tell you, we're serving a real God this morning. I have never made any pretense about being a great theologian. But I can tell you this for an absolute fact. As the end draws nearer, I mean, oh, we're near the end. As the end draws nearer, it shall only be the strong who survive. By that statement, I am not implying that we can possess a strength of our own that shall defeat our adversary. I'm referring to God's might and God's strength that we are commanded to stand in. It will be those men, it will be those women who become smart enough to know that by themselves they cannot make it, but we are not by ourselves. Men and women who are not too proud to cry out to God, Lord, lead me through the storm. Lord, lead me into this battlefield. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. Give him praise. Where did David request to be led? Did he say, Lord, lead me to the pasture? I love you, but I'm as limited as you are. Those people who decide whether or not they're going to come to church based upon whether the pastor's going to be there or not are in the peddling business. Because just like Job said, that I was naked when I came to this earth and I'll go away the same way. Just dust, that's all I am, just like you are. But David wasn't crying out to another man. He wasn't crying out to the priest. Wasn't crying out to the pastor, thank God. He was crying out to the God Almighty. Amen. That's where our request needs to be directed to God Jehovah, who said, let there be light, and the sun comes up at his command. Everything that was made is made. Give him your praise. David said, lead me to the rock of ages, the rock in a weary land, the stone that the builders rejected, but elected of God to the chief place, the rock that is higher than I. There must be something greater, unless the rock is beyond our own height. It cannot shelter us, but if we are not careful, we'll miss something of tremendous importance found in verse 3. David concludes the text by saying, listen, for thou hast been, for there has been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. You know, our greatest treasure are the difficulties we have encountered and the memory of a God that walked with us through them. David said, you know, I'm in this predicament. I'm in this mess. Lead me to the rock, because I realize if I can get to the rock, I know what's at the rock. My God, how many know what's at the rock? How many know what the rock is? How many know that you can't be moved from the rock? If you can get to the rock will hold you. I've used this illustration so much, I don't want to use it again, but I'm going to. Little boy, in the midst of the worst storm that he'd ever encountered on a ship, it absolutely destroyed the ship that he was on, and he found shelter that night, or safety that night, on a huge rock just offshore. The next morning, the search and rescue mission went out searching for survivors. Found a little boy shivering, cold, wet, huddled up on that rock, trying to make conversation that would soothe him and comfort him. One of the rescuers said, young man, wasn't that a terrible storm we encountered last night? Didn't the wind howl and didn't it rain pellets? The young boy said, yes, sir, it was a terrible storm. It was a mighty storm, but the rock didn't move.
Praise God.
I've been there and I've done that. Is anybody here can say, man, God, you ever been there? You ever spent the night on the rock? You ever spent the day on the rock? Whenever all around you things were falling apart, all around you everything was going over under, but thank God the rock refused to move. Crystal River, come to your music. I feel the rock this morning. My God, I know that there's a place for me and a place for you in that rock. Stand with me all over the house. Bible school 101, I guess you'd call it. We all, I don't know, it makes no difference about denominations. If you went to Bible school, everybody knew this song. Glory, hallelujah. I shall not be moved. Anchored in Jehovah. I shall not be moved, just like a tree. Standing by the water, I shall not be moved. The only way with any kind of assurance whatsoever that we can sing that little song that all of us know is to plant our feet on and in the rock and say, my God, I shall not be moved, not because of my stability, but the stability of the rock. Give him praise this morning. I can guarantee you, in closing, I can guarantee you that if things are going well in your house, you can say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But then your house gets out of your house and goes and makes a house of their own. And while it may be pleasant in your house, if you've got little children that you sent out into this world, it's not going well in their house, then it messes your house up. But I tell you, God is bigger than all of it. God is bigger than all of it. Can you imagine your mother and your father, what they went through with trying to bring you up? I can't imagine the nights that they would went to sleep praying, God, wake him up. Help him to realize what he's doing, and I did. And so did you. This sermon this morning, it may not be about your house. It may be about the house that you sent out into the world. It's got your house disturbed because things are not going well there. And then again, it may be at home.